Hi, I'm Julia, a member of the Faith New Testament Church of God. And when I heard of the passing of our dear brother Pilgrim, I was saddened. However, I thought of him singing in that celestial choir because he loved music and he loved to sing. And my fondest memory is when we visited his home and my son played for him and he got his harmonica. And he started to play along with him. And he would be asking him, what song are you playing? Because he during practice and practice just so that he can treat him by playing for him on the guitar. So to show tribute from my family, the Kirtons family, my son is going to play a short song for him. And I just want to say that God be with you. And I know that you will sleep in peace. And to Phyllis, his wife, our dear sister in Christ, and his children, and his entire family circle, and all the members of faith, we want to just extend our condolences. May he rest in peace and rise in glory. Thank you.
I went over to Kirton Church and was directing the choir. After listening to the choir, I approached Brother Pilgrim and asked him if he would come over to Church Village and help us out. At the first word, he smiled. And then he said, "I'll think about it and I'll give you a call." Yes, within 2 days later, he called and he said, yes, he will come. From that time, Brother Pilgrim came over to Church Village and directed choir at Church Village, to which when he come, we give a lot of trouble. He have a lot of trouble on his hand, because when Brother Pilgrim giving us one chord, we going in a different direction. Brother Pilgrim was very quiet, very patient, never ever turning back on us. He wait, and when we finished, he said, "Well, all right, when I had one time, come, this is where we are going." I never seen Brother Pilgrim for all the years that I know him. I never seen Brother Pilgrim ever vexed yet. He always smiling, very pleasant, very humble, and a very quiet person I know Brother Pilgrim to be. For the years that we went on, we could call Brother Pilgrim anytime. Church Village became Brother Pilgrim's second home. Brother Pilgrim, you are gone, but you will ever be remembered at Church.
Cotton family from Virginia Beach. Uncle's my uncle, everybody's uncle, he was my uncle. What I want to say is, I left the United States 55 years ago and moved to Virginia, and I've been living there ever since. But I got a special uncle that visited. My mom was his brother, was his sister. And when she got sick, well, let me back up. As a little kid, I remember Unc making chairs, fixing chairs, having a cool smile. And he was the first man I know that had a tap. At that time, as a toddler, I had no idea what it was. But he impressed me because he was always cool and he was always there and always made himself accessible to us. I learned how to ride on his bicycle. I think I must have broke it a few times, but he knew how to fix it. And he knew how to keep all 25 of his nieces and nephews in track and keep us smiling. Over the years, Unc went to England, I went to Virginia, hadn't seen him in years, and then we connected again. I remember when my mom got sick and he was there. He flew down from Barbados to spend time with her. He got sick while he was there, but it didn't matter. He was there and he was happy to see her. After she passed, he came to the funeral. During the time, my son got married, and I remember Unc came down with all of my aunties, and we had a house with, I don't know, 25 bedrooms, 4 bedrooms. And they slept on the floor, they slept on each other, and they slept. But they were all over the house, and the family had a really, really good time. Whenever I came home to visit, which is almost every 2 years in the last 10 years, I would go see Unc, I would see Aunt Phyllis. I always got a coconut, a green, nice green coconut, and a mango. He told me, the last time I spoke to him, he told me the monkeys took over the mango tree. So I couldn't get any mangoes. About 2 months ago, I got a call. I was in my house, and I got a call from Barbados on the house phone. We never answered a house phone, but I answered, and it was Unc. And he called me, and we talked for about 15 to 20 minutes. I hadn't spoken to him, and last time I was here was in 2019. I hadn't spoken to him since I left, but he called, and he told me, you know, he wasn't doing well. But we talked, and we laughed, and all was well. And again, I asked him, we talked about the mango trees and we talked about the coconuts. That's when he told me the monkeys are taking over the trees and the dogs are chasing the monkeys. So when I leave here, Aunt Phyllis, I'm gonna go by the house and see if I can A, chase a monkey or find a mango. Unc for me, he was a special guy. He was a warm, kind person. I don't know him as well as some of my cousins do, because I didn't do the England part, and I don't live in Barbados, but I know whenever I saw him and whenever I got up with him, it was always enjoyable, and it was always a smile on his face. I have many pictures that I have of him and his sisters and his cousins and his wife and everybody else, and I just, it's memories that I would never forget. I would always cherish it, and I would always cherish him. I'd say today that while we're here, instead of mourning Unc's loss, I think we should celebrate his life and be gracious for the time that we had with him, because he was one awesome human being. Thank you. Have a great day.
When all of the dead in Christ shall rise, I'll have a new body. Praise the Lord, I'll have a new life. Sown in weakness, raised in power, ready to live in paradise. I'll have a new body. Praise the Lord, I'll have a new life. Oh yes,
new hope.
Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Not a shadow can rise, not a cloud in the skies, but his smile quickly drives it away. Not a doubt nor a fear, not a sigh nor a tear can abide while we trust and obey. Oh, trust and obey. To trust and obey. Then in fellowship sweet, we will sit at his feet, or we'll walk by his side in the way. What he said, where he sends, we will go. Never fear, only trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Oh, trust and obey. No other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
If you could see what I once was, if you could go with me back to where I started from, then I know you would see a miracle of love that took me in its sweet embrace and made me what I am today. Just an old sinner saved by grace.
I'm just a took my place. for persons who are coming to use the podium, those of you who will be coming to do the lesson and the opening prayer, as you approach the podium, just place your hand under this device so that your hands can be sanitized before you proceed. So as you come to the podium, whether you're coming to do the lesson or tribute, as the case may be, all you need to do, don't touch anything, just place your hand under it, and it will sanitize you automatically. Thank you. You'll be starting and commencing the service in 2 minutes.
Shall we stand? For I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. And though after my skin worms destroy this body, yet in my flesh shall I see God, whom I shall see for myself, and mine eyes shall behold, and not another. Though my reins be consumed within me. So let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. But I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. The late Randall Pilgrim, having taken his celestial departure, it is with faith in Jesus Christ that we receive his earthly tabernacle for burial, with the hope and the assurance that he will rise to perfection in the first resurrection. Let us therefore with confidence give thanks to God and our Heavenly Father, who is the giver and the sustainer of life, and the one who has allotted our days. We have come today to celebrate the life of a champion for me, one who loved the Lord, one who has been very dear to us, to my family, and to the family here at Faith. We will miss this gentleman, simple, quiet, soft-spoken, was loved by everyone, even the smallest child in this house. The children and the youth loved him. We'll miss his presence and the tremendous ministry that he brought to us here at Faith. But we have the assurance that if we should live in right relationship with God, that this is not the end of the story, that we shall see him again according to the word of the Lord. This time I want to invite Sister Cora Beckles, sister-in-law, to come at this time, director of the prayer ministry here at Faith, to come and invoke God's presence and blessings upon this service today of celebration. We've come to celebrate his life and to give thanks for his life. Then immediately after this, our Sister Connolly is going to come and direct in worship in Jesus' name. Mm-hmm.
Blessed good morning to all. Martha said unto Jesus, if thou was here, my brother would not have died. Jesus saith unto her, thy brother shall rise again. Martha said unto him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. Father in heaven, this morning, we humble our hearts in your presence today. We thank you for this divine opportunity, Lord, wherewith we can gather here to celebrate, Lord, Father, the life and the departure of our dear brother in the Lord. Father, we just want to thank you for his life here on earth. And we pray today, Lord God, as we celebrate with the family, giving unto you thanks and praise for all that you have done in his life. Oh, Lord, we invoke your presence and ask that you would take divine control of this service. We pray, God, that this would be a time of celebration and thanksgiving unto you. Because, Lord, Martha was saying, Lord, that we have to wait until the morning of that resurrection to see your glory. But you reminded her that you are the resurrection. She was looking at the resurrection. And many of us think that we are waiting, Lord, until that day when we will be resurrected. But if we live in you, we are already seeing your resurrected power. So, Father, we stand in you today. And, Lord, your word said, Lord, that if a grain of corn do not die, but if it die and fall into the ground, it is not alone, it shall bring forth. We pray at this funeral service this morning, somebody's heart will be touched, drawn closer to you. Someone that does not really know you, Lord God, would have a passion to draw near. Breathe upon this service today, and all that should be said and done, may it be done to thine honor and to thy glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning to everyone. Songwriter says, when peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to know, it is well with my soul. I'm sure it is well with Brother Pilgrim's soul this morning.
When peace like a wave
It is well. It is well. It is well. Hallelujah. With my soul. We're going to have our first reading now done by Shirley Matthias. She's going to read from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, 13 to 18.
Praise the Lord. Praise God. It is well with my soul. That was the last song that my uncle sung with me when I asked him what he would like me to sing for him. And he said, it is well with my soul. And he said, I surrender all. And today I give him the praise and the glory because he has made his way in. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Here beginneth our chapter, Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13. But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that he sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so then, also which sleep in Jesus, with God bring with him. For this we say unto you, by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a cloud, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the cloud to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. Today I know my uncle is with the Lord. Hallelujah.
Amen. Hallelujah. He's with the Lord. And he's listening to us. And we want to celebrate on his behalf. Brother Pilgrim loved this song, when my life work is ended. And I crossed the swelling tide. And he worked hard. I don't know about the other times, but I know when he was practicing us, he was working hard. He put up with us. When the bright and glorious morning, I shall see. I shall know my Redeemer. When I reach the other side, and his smile, hallelujah, will be the first to welcome me.
I shall know him.
we shall know him by the print of the nails. Hallelujah. In his hand. And all those who think that we are making sport and don't know what we're talking about, ready or not, the Lord is coming. He is coming. And we shall know him. Hallelujah. Sister Joyanne Blenmon is going to do our second reading, Revelation 21, 1 to 8.
Good morning. And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from heaven, coming from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be with their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. And he that sat upon the throne said, behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, write, for these words are true and faithful. And he said unto me, it is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of water of life freely. He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be with him, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. But the fearful, the unbelieving, the abominable, murderer, and the whoremongers, and the sorcerers, and the idolaters, and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. Here ends the second reading. Praise the Lord. I have a tribute to do for Uncle Pilgrim. It was compiled by, I will say, his nieces. We were not blood nieces, but it felt so, and he was, in my opinion. First is from Jonelle. She remembered when she was a little girl, and he came home with Auntie Phyllis from England. His quiet spirit. She'd never seen Pilly angry or vexed. If he was vexed, he never showed it. Always have a smile on his face, and always willing to help you if you're doing anything. He loves his music. He led the choir at Faith New Testament Church of God for years, and the choir better get it right. If they didn't, he will stop the choir and they'll have to start all over again. I never heard his voice loud at any time. Just how he lived his life, he died. So quietly, he will be missed. But if we live with the Lord, we will see him again. We love him. May his soul rest in peace and may he rise in glory. From Patricia, Brother Pilgrim, Uncle Pilgrim, gone too soon. I remember Uncle Pilgrim for his heavenly angel singing. Oh yes, what a voice. There were times when you would forget you were a part of the choir as you would pause to hear the change of key. He sang like a lark, with every note so clear and clean, echoing across the church. There is so much more I would say about Brother Pilgrim, but time is against me. I can still hear his laughter when he gives stories about living in England. But this I must say, sing on, keep singing, Jesus bid you come. Rosalind, humble, peaceful, loving, kind, and adorable, contented, smiling person he was. Our Uncle Pilgrim, as we call him, with the charming smile. Before you can get close to him, his smile reaches you first. Sleep on in Christ, Uncle Pilling. Keisha, as a child growing up, living around family was not a dull moment. Uncle Pilly was unquestionably that person who made a long-lasting impression while growing up. Without looking, you would know Uncle Pilgrim is coming down the line. When you hear that contagious cackle, you know he's coming to crack a joke or to distribute those lovely sweets, which, by the way, we never knew the correct name for them. We just labeled them sweets from England. Imagine knowing a man all your life and never heard him raise his voice or seen him angry. That alone showcased the exemplary human being he was. Those are the ones you cherished the most and never forgot. Rest in peace, Uncle Pilgrim. Andrea, Uncle Pilgrim, I just want to say what an amazing gentleman you are. Uncle, father figure, you were to me. When I was growing up, I was getting out of hand. You'd be the only one I listened to. And she has here and a smile on her face. Because you knew life and will always set me straight, giving me guidance and letting me know what to understand about life. Because of you, I am the amazing lady I am today. You were funny, you were kind, loving, humble, and one of a kind. I will never forget. May your soul rest in peace. Love, Andrea, always. Joanne, for a man of few words, I have so much to say. Who is this man? To most, he is Mr. Pilgrim, Brother Pilgrim, or Uncle Pilgrim. But for me, he is Uncle Pilgrim, or Dad. Our journey began when Uncle Pilgrim and Auntie Phyllis migrated home from England. I remember the bond that started with a shipping container, which was the first time I've ever seen or heard about anything called a container. He explained its purpose to me and that it was the only way they can get their furniture to Barbados. He had expressed how happy he was to be back home. He hated the cold. One of the stories of England he shared, start quote, one evening after work, I got the bus home, and on the way, I wanted to use the bathroom. I prayed for the driver to go faster or for people to stop boarding. It was like the bus was standing still. Jumping out at my stop, I ran to the door. I thought I had conquered it, but it was a lie. Putting my hands in my pocket to get my key, my hand started to tremble. Finally getting them out, and it got worse. Hands picked up a violent shake. Couldn't get the key in the hole at all. Then there was this hot feeling, and before I could look down, the pee had frozen on my feet. End quote. He taught me all the tools in his workshop and what they were for. I remember the many times he would call my mom to send me over. And on reaching there, he just wanted help putting a screw or two in a hole so he can fasten it. The few seconds that I was supposed to be there turned into whole day visits. We would wash dishes and clean the house. I had tried once the shortcut doing the chores, and he said to me, no, never do that. Your aunt is too clever for that. She will come in and use her finger and pass it along the surfaces, and she will know. He said, you must do it right. And in his British accent, ain't it? He loves Auntie Phyllis so much. He just wanted to please her. So we tag team on the house chores. We would always leave the backyard for last. So when Auntie comes home, we were outside. Two reasons for loving the mango tree, the sweet mangoes on it, and to get away outside. When Auntie Phyllis comes in and he will say, Phil, I'm outside raking. On our walks to church, to and from church, he hardly spoke. And if he did, it was about music notes, music symbols, or the music scale. We would just walk and sing one song after the next till we reached the church. If we were late, which was seldom, he would raise his index finger. Or if he was leaving, he would do the same. I found it odd as a child, but it was his way to say, excuse me, or pardon me. He was a good confidant. Andrew and I spent our summer vacations with him every day. This one day in particular, he didn't see us and came overlooking. He was like, girls, where are you? We were on top of our late cousin's marked wardrobe and advised him not to come in. Andrea had beaten the pit bull. The pit bull had pulled all the clothes that we had put out on the line, and it got away and ran us. Our only escape was on top of the wardrobe. He had then to get the dog's owner, Winston. Uncle Pilgrim saved us that day. Another occasion, he was eating a tomato which he had picked from his garden, and we wanted one as well. It was so red and pretty, and sure enough, he gave us one each and watched us bite. You can imagine the look on our faces. Uncle Pilgrim laughed so hard and long before he saying, here, try a pinch of salt. One year, Auntie Phyllis went on a trip. Uncle Pilgrim asked me to come over every Saturday afternoon. Why? Just to pick out his clothes. For the weeks Auntie Phyllis was away, he wanted me to do that. He said, your aunt always put them out for me. And she said she's not pre-doing it. She is not doing it. And you have to manage and get on with it. And you better get it right, cause she will check. So hence, I had a job every Saturday since he said he was colorblind. So much memories of Uncle Pilgrim, like being my driving instructor. I remember him laughing at me, saying, I forgot I put kangaroo petrol in the car because it was bunging forward. I couldn't manage to get the clutch balance at all. He taught Andrea and I how to use knife and fork since we spent most Sundays with Auntie Phyllis and Uncle Pilgrim. He built my first daughter's cradle. I love you, Uncle Pilgrim. I will never, ever meet another man like you. I never once heard you raise your voice, never heard you yell, not even when you were calling for Auntie Phyllis. You would say, Phil or Phyllis, as if you were singing. In closing, I remember sitting next to you. We were having roll call at church. You responded present and quoted the scripture, which up to now, I could not make out because you are so soft-spoken. And then the strangest thing happened. You started to sing. Yeah, sing. What a day that will be. And the church joined in as you sat. You leaned over to me and explained what the words meant to you, saying, imagine Jesus meeting you and taking you by the hand and leading you through the promised land. As you look, as you look upon his face, there be no sickness, there be no pain. Uncle Pilgrim then said, when I die, please sing this song at my funeral. I said, I wanted it sang at mine as well. And we looked at each other and smiled. I can see you now. What a day the 24th of September 2021 has been. The day of my late dad's birthday. And the day that Jesus met you and held you by the hand and led you through the promised land.
There is coming a day when no heartache shall come, no more clouds in the sky, no more tears to dim the eyes. All is peace forevermore on that happy golden shore. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. When I look upon his face, the one who saved
Praise the Lord. What a glorious day. What a day that is going to be. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. We want to thank our sister Joanne for sharing those tremendous tributes for us, reflecting the quality, the character, and the attitude of a gentleman, one who loved the Lord dearly. But this time we're going to have the tribute from his niece.
Good morning to Reverend Connolly, to the members of Faith New Testament Church of God, to family and friends this morning. I'm going to greet you in the mighty name of Jesus. I'm going to speak to you about, and looking at the front of your program, it says from sunrise to sunset. But I'm going to speak to you this morning about the dash between the sunrise and the sunset. Today, I'm honored to speak about a husband, father, grandfather, brother, and uncle. Some of his friends and some of his relatives called him Fi, but I called him Uncle Randall. He was also my father. My earliest memory of Uncle Randall was hearing him speak of being my babysitter when my parents went to work. And whenever he saw me, he would remember the lashes that my mother gave him. This was because all I did was cried and would not go to sleep as a baby. And this also stopped Uncle Randall from going and setting fly sticks to catch his birds. And he also had a tune where he used to tweet and the birds would come. He told me all about this. And what did my uncle do to get his punishment? He introduced me to some rum in my milk and put me to sleep. When my mother came home, she could not get me wake up. So Uncle Randall decided to run from River Plantation, but someone caught him and took him back and he got his lashes. And he always speak about this, no matter who is there. He said, you see this woman here? She caused me to get lashes. She caused me to get lashes. But this morning, I'm speaking about a man whose strength was great when it came to building and fixing things. He knew his tools, his hammer, and his nails, and also his ruler. Whatever he was making, it had to be perfect. He would cane a chair and polish it. This was also one of his passions. Just ask, and he would help you. His other strength was singing. My uncle knew his notes. He sang soprano and alto, and he would throw something else in there. He just loved to sing. On a cruise to the Turks and Caicos Islands, we stopped by a church, and all he heard was the organ playing. While we were looking around at the stores, my uncle found the church. The choir director was practicing for her service, and guess what? Uncle Randall just joined in with her. He could fit in anywhere. I tell you, that was one day that I would never forget. He was just singing to the top of his voice. And at the end, we found out that the choir director was from Barbados. He was very loyal. He never got into anything that did not concern him. Uncle Randall was a humble, kind, and loving person. He loved children. He knew how to make anyone laugh when he told old stories. I can tell you the way that Uncle Randall remembered my grandchildren, my great-grandchildren. We were on a cruise, and my great-grandson, he was no more about 4 or 5 years old, and in boarding the ship, he had to take his belt off so it wouldn't go off, and Uncle Randall said, but he knew what to do. I forget mine. Then I had another granddaughter at the age of 2 and 3. I don't know where she got the word from, but when he's sitting down and he visited New York, she used to pass, "You got an attitude, bad attitude." So he called her Miss Attitude. He never remembered her name as Tanaya, but whenever he called, he wants to know, "How is Miss Attitude?" My cousins and I had fun days with him in Pilgrim Road, England, and when he visited the USA. He was a man of dignity. He treated everyone with care and compassion, from the youngest to the oldest. He was a dresser. He was a dapper. And I made sure that he was a dapper. He came to New York and we went in the store. I said, "Unks, you like that?" "Mm-hmm." "Unks, you like that?" "Mm-hmm." "But jolly, you can only get me one." "Unks, you like that?" And I remembered Uncle Randall calling me and said to me that he came to church, because I made sure he had some tuxedo jackets and the pants to match. And he said, "Girl, you don't know how those women were looking at me in church." I said, "Unks, you know, I put you way well." He loved to dress. And he was clean, real clean, nice clothes, but the best thing was his smile. Uncle Randall, you will be missed by all. You are no longer sitting under the tree looking at the stars. You are now one of them. You are one of those stars. Shine on. We love you. Rest in peace, Uncle Randall, and rise in glory.
I want to thank his niece, Emily Pilgrim, for sharing those kind remarks with regards to this champion of a man and tremendous memories. And he's really made an indelible mark upon so many of our lives. At this time, we're going to have a very special presentation. There are those from the church at Faith that would have loved to be here, those whom he had been had the opportunity to be the choir master. Some of them have moved on. Some of them have relocated. And for this special day, this day of celebration and thanksgiving, they came together for that one last time to share and minister in a song that they know that he loves so much and that he himself trained, prepared, and worked with them to minister for the honor and the glory of God. So at this time, a very special tribute presentation from the family at Faith.
Sky's not always blue.
May the name of the Lord, blessed be the name of the Lord. That is one of his favorite songs as well. And if you listen closely, you probably would have heard him singing the bass, running from bass to tenor to soprano. Hallelujah. And one thing that always stood out for me for this great servant of the Lord is that he was a sticker for timing too. And if you're dragging the song at all, he will let you know right up front that you just ain't got the timing right. And he'll stop it and start all over again. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Heavenly Father, we invoke your presence even now upon these thoughts that you've deposited in my spirit to share in this house. We pray, O Lord, that your will be done. We thank you for doing so. In Jesus' name, amen. Much has been said about this great soldier of the Lord. And I don't know why the Lord places a topic such like this on my heart to share in this service, but only he knows. I recognize that the service today is about him, but not for him. It's really for us who have been left behind to ensure that when that day or that time comes, we too will be able to see him again. Lady Pilgrim, 58 years is not 2 days. There are individuals who cannot make it 3 months in their marriage relationship. Y'all have done well. It's a tremendous witness and testimony to what trust and confidence in God can do. And I really want to commend you as well for staying at the side of the one that you love so much. The way how our brother slipped from time to eternity was truly amazing. And we'll probably hear more about that a bit later. But there's a thought that has come into my, that's brought to my attention to just share with you, and it's really simply entitled, A Day Is Coming. The song that our sister sang was not by accident, because it was one of the songs that we said we'd have had on the program as well too, What a Day That Will Be. The Lord placed upon my heart to just share a few thoughts around this most important matter. A day is coming. The Apostle Paul, in his writings to the young man Timothy, 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 1 to 8, makes some very strong statements to this young man. He loved Timothy. And it is said that one must pay the earnest attention to the words spoken by someone when they're in their final moments of life. The things that they share with you are not only precious, but they are priceless. And the Apostle Paul, this portion of scripture referred to, in fact, as Paul's deathbed statement, so to speak. For he knew that his time was at hand, and he brought his young spiritual son, and he gave him specific instruction with regards to the mind and the will of God. And in this text, he says to Timothy, 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1, he says, I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. He says, preach the word, be instant in season and out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lusts shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. And they shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned unto fables or stories. But he says to Timothy, watch thou in all things, endure afflictions, do the work of an evangelist. And then he says, make full proof of thy ministry. Make full proof of thy ministry. Paul goes on to say, for I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing. Paul charges this young man, and he makes the statement to him in that very first verse. He says, I charge thee before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. If you don't understand anything else that I say to you today, those within the sanctuary and the many who have joined in across social media to join in this service of celebration and thanksgiving, I want to say to us today, for each of us within the hearing of my voice, that regardless of how short your life is or how long your life is, you can be sure that a day is coming when we will all have to give an account of our lives and our witness on this side of earth. In fact, the scripture reminds us in Hebrews chapter 9 and verse 27 that it is appointed unto man once to die, but after death, a day of judgment is coming. Paul says to Timothy, a day is coming, Timothy, when you will have to answer to God. A day of judgment is coming, when God will judge both the living and the dead at his appearing. And he says to Timothy, I want for you to seriously consider, and I say the same thing to us today, I want for us to pause for a moment and consider, what will we say when we stand before God to give an account of the things that we've done on this side of life. Paul spoke to Timothy from the bottom of his heart and reminded him of this. In fact, in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and verse 16, he affirms it. He says, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. Hallelujah. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. And therefore he goes on to say, wherefore comfort one another with these words. I say to you today, a day is coming, hallelujah, when we shall have to give an account of our lifestyle and the relationship and the way in which we have conducted ourselves on this side of life. The fact of the matter is, one, not only is that day coming, but secondly, the certainty of the day. The certainty of the day. It is sure that that day is coming. It makes no difference how much money you have on the bank account, how wealthy you are, how much you possess on this side of life, whether you're a prime minister, a governor, or premier of a land, a day is coming when all of us have to pass the same way that this giant of a man have passed, where we'll say farewell to this side of the earth. But I want to say to us today, that is not the end of the story. A day of accountability is coming when we shall stand before God and we have to give an account of the deeds within our bodies. So there is the certainty of the day. Not only is there a certainty of a day, but interestingly enough, the scripture tells us that there is an uncertainty of the hour. For no man knows when that day will be. The Bible says that our times are in his hands. Just yesterday, when I turned in for work, one of my staff members rushed upstairs to me and said, boss, have you heard? I said, heard what? Have you heard that Callie is gone? Says, how you mean Callie is gone? I just spoke to him last week. How you mean he's gone? Say, yes, he's gone. One of our staff members next door, a young man, he went to school with me as well. Late 40s, early 50s, slipped from time into eternity with the impact of this pandemic. Left a beautiful wife wonderful child, just like that. The uncertainty of the hour is presented before us. St. Matthew chapter 24 and verse 42 says, "Watch therefore, for you know not what hour your Lord doth come." But in verse 43 he says, "But know this, that if the good man of the house had known in what watch the thief would have come, he would have watched and would not have suffered his house to be broken up." Then in verse 44, he gives the urgency. He says, because of this, he said, "Therefore be ye also ready, for in such an hour as you think not, the Son of Man cometh." No one knows when he will come. The important thing is to be ready. There are two messages I share wherever I go today. I have the, I don't know what to call it, challenge, privilege, opportunity. As I work and serve among all the COVID sites and centers, two messages I share wherever I go. Make sure you know God for yourself. Make sure you know God for yourself. The experience of a friend, a mother, a father knowing the Lord is good, but it's important for you to know God for yourself, especially in these times of uncertainty. And then secondly, make sure whatever price you have to pay, that you spend your time in his presence. Those are the two most important things for us today. Scripture says that we need to be ready. Not only we should be ready because a day of separation is coming. St. John chapter 5 and verse 28, the scripture says, "Marvel not at this, for the hour is coming in which all that are in the graves." No wonder the scripture says, absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. This is just a transitory moment for our good friend and servant in the Lord. The Bible says a day is coming. Hallelujah. My Lord, when the trumpet of God shall sound, the dead in Christ shall rise. And we who are alive and remain shall be caught up to meet. So the Bible says, marvel not at this, for this hour is coming in which all, it says, all that in the grave shall hear his voice and shall come forth. And hear this. He says, they that have done good unto the resurrection life, and they that have done evil unto the resurrection of damnation. Can I say today, we don't talk much about it, but it is true, you know. There is a place called heaven, and there is a place called hell. Whether you accept it, whether you believe it, whether you receive it or not, you cannot change that fact, because it's stated clearly in the Word of God. A time of separation comes on that day, where we are separated based upon our relationship with God and where we accepted him as our Lord and Savior. Paul said to Timothy, "Timothy, I want you to position yourself as a young man. Because of the uncertainty of the times, the one thing that will change the course and the lives of others is to preach the word. Let the word be known by your life and by your witness. And make full proof of your ministry." Our brother Randall made full proof of his ministry. He enjoyed the ministry of worship and sound. And he embedded that in many of us. Paul in this statement says, "For I am now ready to be offered." In having discussions with the family, Roger and Lady Pilgrim, but the Pilgrim knew that his day was coming. He knew his day was coming. I remember the last communion service we had together, last time of celebration, he knew that that day was coming. And as we were praying and believing and thinking about, Lord, we really believe you for a miracle because this is what you told us to do. He was all the time preparing himself for leaving. And there's a song that he sang over and over again. In fact, he sang it about three times, a chorus that he loved very much. He sang it about three times during that last communion service a few weeks ago. All that I am. All that I am. And all that I ever be cannot repay the debt that I owe. I surrender to you. I heard him sing the bass for it. Then the next time he sang the tenor. Next time he sang the soprano. And then from that song, he very quietly slipped in to the other chorus that he loves. You are Lord. You are Lord. You are risen from the dead. And you are Lord. He had the certainty and the assurance that he was going. In fact, the family reported that he turned and he said to Roger, Roger, I'm leaving you. I'm leaving you. That's what he said. He said, I'm leaving you. I said, what do you mean you're leaving me? He said, no, I'm leaving you. I'm leaving you. He knew that his time was at hand. Because he had made full proof of his ministry. Just like the Apostle Paul. Paul says, and the time of my departure is at hand. Brother Pilgrim was in that same place. He knew that his time of departure was at hand. And God gave him the opportunity to be able to say to his family, I'm getting ready to leave you. I'm leaving you. Such was the assurance that he had in his heart in his life. You know why? Because he had fought a good fight. Hallelujah. His attitude, his demeanor, his conduct, we heard it so much this morning. He was one of the most pleasant, simple, and heavenly men that you could meet on this side of earth. Never unruffled at all. He has finished his course. He has finished his course. He was an authority on music. He loved music dearly. Not only here, but he trained national choirs overseas as well and assisted many churches across this island. And everywhere he went, he was loved. He was loved. There was something about him that caused persons to just love him. His life was exemplary. One of humility, one of patience. It's something that young people need to take out of his book. Know how to be patient and keep your mouth shut and be quiet. Exemplify peaceful disposition. You would live longer if you learn to do that. You have less stress too. But he was one who God had so touched and blessed that he knew how to remain calm and cool. And unsettled in spite of everything that may be going on around him. He loved his family, and he took good care of his family as well, too. I assure you that he's going to be missed by all here at Faith. He had a very special place in my family. Myself and his wife and my wife, we had some good camaraderie together. He always referred to Lady Connolly as his other wife. And I always referred to Lady Pilgrim as my other wife. So we were literally sharing. But he was well respected and admired. He has finished his course. And the Bible says, henceforth is laid up for him a crown of righteousness. Not only for him, the Bible says, but unto all them. All them also that love his appearing. As we close this service today, I pray that the life and the witness and the testimony of this gentleman will certainly cause us, those on the inside and those who have heard my voice today, to reflect upon the fact that a day is coming when we have to give our accountability to God. Every one of us. And if you don't know the Lord as your Savior, if you don't have a personal relationship with him, there's no better time than to do it than now. The Bible says, behold, today is the day of salvation. Now is the day of salvation. If you hear him knocking at your door, harden not your heart. But if you open, he will come in and he will sup with you. God has been so good to this couple. I think our Lady Pilgrim shared with me that the way how he transitioned, I turned and I said to brother, I would really love to leave like that. I would really love to leave like that. So peaceful and so quiet, no fuss at all. That's what it is to mean to love the Lord. Lady Pilgrim reminded and shared with me a very intimate moment that she had with him just before he slipped from time to eternity. She was trying to get him to sit in the chair while she was on the bed trying to transition him from where he was. And she said to him, I want you to put your hand around me once so that you don't fall. But I want you to hug me like how you hugged me the first time when we met. Hold me tight. And Brother Pilgrim did just that. He placed his hand around his wife. She placed her hand around him and they hugged each other. She placed him in the chair. And the next few moments, he was gone from time to eternity. What a precious moment and a priceless moment to experience love and the expression of love even in those moments. God knew and the angels knew. I pray today that the witness of his life will certainly impact ours and cause us to understand it's not over. Death is not the end, but a day is coming when we shall all be gathered. The Bible says, from the north and from the south and from the east and from the west, we shall all be gathered. Hallelujah. I don't care if they cremate you. I don't care if they burn you up. I don't care what they do with you. When the trumpet of God sounds, the God that we serve, hallelujah. The word says that this mortal shall put on immortality, and this which is corruptible shall put on corruption. What a day, a glorious day that is going to be. I look forward to seeing him again and joining with him in the celestial choir, when our voices will be perfect, no crackling sounds, but perfect, and be able to join in the melodious praise and worship of our King and Kings and Lord of Lords. May he rest in peace, and we look forward to seeing him in glory. Praise the Lord. I'm going to ask the immediate family, the relatives, to come and stand around the casket at this time. We're going to offer a very special prayer for all of you. We want to pray for you at this time. Just stand, immediate family. The others that are not able to can stay just where they are. We'll pray for you as well, just where you are. give yourself enough space. If you're not from the same household, still keep your distance. In the name of the Lord, thank you. Minister Singh is going to come quickly and offer this very special prayer before we sing the closing song. Prepare ourselves in Jesus' name.
Our Father, who is in heaven, holy is your name.
Yes, Lord.
Great is your name. Majestic is your name. We believe in your name. And we trust in your name. We find comfort in your name. We obtain salvation in your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. And so, Father, we lift up today Sister Pilgrim and Roger and the relatives of Brother Pilgrim, cousins and niece and nephews and sisters and brothers, those that are here. We lift them up before you, Father, and we pray that the grace of God may abound towards them, that the peace of God, which transcends all human understanding, shall guard their hearts and their minds through Jesus Christ. We pray, O Lord, that you will spread your arms around them and that they will feel your comfort, they will feel your nearness, and they will know your love. O Lord, and those who do not know you as Lord and Savior, that they will come to know you, that they will come into fellowship and relationship with you in the name of Jesus Christ. And so, Lord, during this time of bereavement, of sorrow, and of grief, O Lord, we ask that you will succor them, that you will uphold them with the right arm of your righteousness, and that you will give them the strength to go through the spirit, Lord, the spirit of grief. Lord, that you will strengthen them, Lord, that you will be there for them, and that you will bless them, O Lord. We pray, Lord Jesus, that Lord, as they continue to reflect on the life of their lost loved one, Lord, that they will draw inspiration, and that they, Lord, will be inspired by his faith and by his commitment and dedication to serve the Lord. And they, Lord Jesus, in turn, will do the same. Bless them all today in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost. Amen and amen.
Yourselves as the director comes to lead in the moment of
when Brother Pilgrim slipped from time into eternity, we were together. He wasn't talking because of the problem he had in his throat. He could hardly speak. But as I told the pastor, just let him know how fortunate it was for me to be there when Brother Pilgrim slipped from time into eternity. Simply saying, giving you all 5 minutes, let you all know that God is good. I could have gone into the kitchen and come back and find Brother Pilgrim dead. And I think it would be worse for me more than it is now. But God has made it so possible for me, because I know he couldn't swallow, but I bring in liquid. I took liquid in the bedroom. And I took him out the bed, as Pastor said. And I tried my best. Roger was not home. But I told him what to do so I can get him from the bed into the chair transition. And we did it. He tried his best and we made it. And I said, Dan, what would you like to drink? I bring you juice, I bring you water, and I bring you tea. Which one you like? So said, but you have to take something because you know that you haven't taken anything for days. I said, try for me. He told me no. And I went, I lie on the bed, on the side of the bed, with that grief in my soul because I know you haven't eaten for days, didn't drink for days. I was wondering, what do I do and where do I go from here? From here. But I lie there, I lie back on the pillow and I watch Brother Pilgrim. He's sitting there and I lie in the bed here. And I start to talk to the Lord. I said, God, I've got to hurdle this. I don't know how. I can't feed him. I don't want the doctors to put tube down him. I'm not going to let him go into the hospital. What do I do? I said, God, you've got to help me out of this. You promise times like this. As I lie back there now with the tears in my eyes, Brother Pilgrim sitting in the wheelchair, as I said, I just put him. And I see Brother Pilgrim, I left his head up. When I looked over at Dad, I saw Dad do like this and bow his head. And his hands came off of the side of the wheelchair where he placed his hands. I said, Dad, are you ready for a drink? He did not answer. And I got up from there off the bed and just go there. And I lift his head up again and said, Dad, are you ready? You want something to drink? I said, you're dehydrated. You must have a little. He didn't answer. So I let his head go and it dropped again onto his chest. I said, Dad is not all right. And I lift his head again. I said, come on, Dad. Come on, come with me. I said, come on. Didn't make no response. He answered nothing. And then I let his head go. It dropped there again and his hands and no more movement. Quietly like that, Brother Pilgrim slipped from time into eternity, quiet and peaceably. I just want the church to know, even going through, watching him slipping away from day to day, but God has done it so wonderfully that he slipped from time into eternity peaceably.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Well, just how he has slipped out from time, God is a great God, and it is a message of hope and assurance for all of us that God is ready to receive us when our lives are in his hands. So the worship team is going to prepare to sing that song, Amazing Grace, one of his special songs, while the pallbearers and family prepare ourselves to leave the sanctuary for the burial. In Jesus' name. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.